Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, phone number 937-323-7508. Today is our Pentecost service. Today is the birthday of the church.
Good morning. And welcome to our worship service this morning as we celebrate the birthday of the church, the festival of Pentecost. We give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Clark County area and looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John your new church home. This being a festival and also Communion Sunday, all of the services in your bulletin, except for the order of confession, which we will do in a minute, and the hymn. So the only time you need this red hymnal is now and for the singing of the hymns. Otherwise, everything else is in your bulletin. So I'd ask that you now turn to page 94 and invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship with the order of confession. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We now begin our worship with hymn number 398, Holy Spirit, Truth Divine, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 398, Holy Spirit, Truth Divine.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Now there was about Jews from every nation under Indeed, these are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Song.
How manifold are your works, O Lord! In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures.
Show us the Father. Do you not believe that I am the Father and the Father is in me?
will do greater works than these, because I'm going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You do not let them be afraid. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you. First of all, I must once again share the passing of one of our members from the Church Militant to the Church Triumphant. Yesterday at 12:30, our sister Patty Leninger was called to the Church Triumphant. We will be meeting with the funeral director tomorrow to set up the arrangements. So please check the newspaper beginning on Tuesday to see what the arrangements are. Yesterday, the talk was it would be a 2-hour visitation and then the funeral immediately afterwards. That could change after tomorrow. So please check the paper beginning on Tuesday, and please remember Patty's family in your prayers and with your condolences. Also, as we have been advertising or promoting, the 60th anniversary of the drive-in worship begins the last Sunday of the month, Memorial Day weekend Sunday. I've shown you the bumper stickers that you can put on your car. Well, this morning out in the back are also posters, which you can take to where you had your hair done or haircut or where you shop or whatever. Yes, and so you can put it in the window on the bulletin board so that we can have advertising around the county about our community drive-in worship from Memorial Day through Labor Day. And all the other announcements, I'd ask that you please make note of in the bulletin. Before we sing our hymn, as you see, the choir's not with us this morning, so we'll be singing the hymn. I just want to share with you a story, something that happened to me yesterday. All of us have seen those movies where someone receives a letter in the mail and it's telling them that some unknown relative is leaving them a whole bunch of money and it changes their whole life because of this unknown relative. Well, yesterday I received an envelope and it was from a law firm in Akron. Well, I've never been to Akron. I've been through it, but I've never stopped. And so I opened it and I'm reading it and said, you've been named in the estate of it. I'm thinking, wow, those things really come true. So I keep on reading it. And it's trying to tell me that I'm a son of some guy living in Akron and I'm entitled to an inheritance with my other two supposed brothers. The funny thing was, they have all three of the brothers listed and they have my name and address, and it's John H. Pollock Jr., but the father's name is Frank Pollock. I'm like, how would you not realize that a John Pollock Jr. couldn't be the son of a Frank Pollock if he's not John Pollock Jr.? So, plus, they spell their name, this person spells his name A-C-K, which usually, not always, but usually, not to offend anyone, but usually when you see P-O-L-A-C-K or P-O-L-L-A-C-K, the person is from Poland or some other Slavic country who came over to the United States and Ellis Island took their name, which was about this long, full of consonants, and jammed it down to this long and made it a pop. My name is Osinke, which means it's from Scott and Irish origin. My dad told the story that when he got off the boat in Northern Ireland for final training before he went to France, that as soon as he got off the boat, the first thing he noticed in Northern Ireland was a shop that said Pollock Apothecary, and then the next store was the Pollock Graduate, and then there was Pollock Pub, and he said, I knew where my father came from. all these poppets. OCJ, not ACJ. So, unfortunately, I don't get to inherit the $343.57. I have to call these lawyers up and say, I don't know who the third son is, but he's not this boy. My daddy never lived in Akron, Ohio, and he's been dead for 11 years. So, it could happen to you. It would be real instead of a misprint. All right, $399, the Holy Spirit renewal. And number 399.
To make arrangements to betray him in the Garden of Gethsemane.
But Jesus is not concerned about himself. Jesus is concerned about his Father. Jesus is concerned about his church. Jesus is concerned about all those who would come to believe in him long after he was crucified, resurrected, and ascended. And so he has given these final teachings to the disciples before his resurrection. And in it he describes the fact that when he goes back to the Father, he is going to send us an advocate, the Holy Spirit. And this is what the Holy Spirit will do for us. The first thing it will do will assure us that we have always with us the peace of God, and that it is in God, through faith in Jesus Christ, that we find peace. As he says in verse 27, and this is the English Standard Version, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, and neither let them be afraid." Peace. To the world, peace means a cessation of hostilities or an end of war. Some historian has done a study, and he came up with this fact that from the beginning of written civilization that we have, some 5,000 years of human civilization, BC through AD, through all that time there have only been 248 years of peace in the world. 248 out of over 5,000. The world is used to turmoil. The world is used to anarchy. The world is used to hostility. The world is used to war. And so people try to find a way to live in such an environment. And it is the Holy Spirit that comes to us and tells us through that faith in Jesus Christ, we can have this peace that passes all understanding. This peace that is with us no matter whether we are in a situation where everything is wonderful or whether we are in a situation that is absolutely tragic. And so the Holy Spirit gives us this peace. And this peace enables us to do things we never imagined we'd be able to do. Think back to the disciples after Jesus speaks to them the night of his betrayal. After he's arrested, most of them flee except for Peter and John. They follow Jesus to Annas and then to Caiaphas. And then Peter denies Jesus three times, and he disappears. And the only disciple that's there on Good Friday at the cross is the disciple John, comforting Jesus' mother, Mary, the mother of our Lord, who takes him in to be as his own mother. All the others are scared, frightened, they're hiding. On that Easter Sunday morning, we read they are in the upper room with the doors and windows locked for fear of the Jews. Jesus comes and stands among them and says, "Peace be with you." And they still can't believe that it's Jesus and that he's risen from the dead. But then Pentecost arrives and transforms these same cowards into soldiers of the Lord Jesus Christ, into an army of evangelists who conquer the mighty Roman Empire. Not an army of swords and spears and bows and arrows and battering rams and fire and destruction, but an army of armed only with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not an army that conquers by weapons and says convert or die, but an army of peaceful people showing love to their enemies, turning the other cheek, and giving to feeding the hungry, clothing the naked, helping the widow, the orphan, the stranger in their midst. All because of the Holy Spirit, giving them this peace that no matter if they were persecuted, no matter what they went through, they still had this peace of God which enabled them to continue to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. In the fifth chapter of the book of Acts, we read of the disciples being arrested. And we read of them being put in front of the Sanhedrin. They were arrested by the temple police because they're in the temple. Preaching Jesus Christ crucified and resurrected. And so the high priest and the Sanhedrin tell him, "You're not to speak Jesus anymore. You don't preach Jesus in this temple." St. Peter, answering for all the disciples, says in verse 29 of that fifth chapter of Acts, we must obey God rather than men. That word obey means to submit to or to follow. We must submit to God rather than men. Now, as Christians, we are supposed to be good citizens. We are supposed to abide by the laws of society as long as they don't conflict with the doctrines of our faith. As long as they do not try to make us deny Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. As long as they do not try to make us give up our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and what he has said. But it is the Holy Spirit that gave Peter and the disciples that peace of knowing God was with them that enabled them to tell us that every day. Well, no, we're not going to stop preaching Jesus in the temple. We're going to preach him in the temple. We're going to preach him in the marketplace. We're going to preach him in Caesarea in front of Pontius Pilate's headquarters. We're going to preach him everywhere we can. So Pentecost comes and reminds us of this peace that we are given. This peace that is with us in illness. This peace that enables us to confront pain or loss. This peace that enables us to confront disappointment and failure. This peace of knowing that we belong to God and that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. For as St. Paul tells us in that famous chapter, eighth chapter of Romans, neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. That is why Pentecost is important. Because it reminds us of that, it assures us of this peace which passes all understanding, this peace which only Jesus can give us. There was an old sea captain who was the captain of a large ship who'd been very successful in his career. And it came time to retire, and he retired, and he spent a number of years with his spouse as he retired, and with his children and grandchildren, and then his spouse was called to heaven, and he was by himself, and so he entered a soldier and sailor's home. Well, unlike his spouse, the old sea captain had not believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. He was a skeptic. He didn't believe in heaven. He didn't believe in the basic doctrines of the Christian faith. And so as he entered this soldier and sailor's home, he soon became friends with the chaplain of the home. And the chaplain was very concerned about this captain's life. And so one day, he came into the sea captain's room and he handed him a New Testament and a red pen and he said, I'm going to give you a challenge. He says, I'm giving you this New Testament and this red pen, and I want you to read it, and I want you to underline anything you can't believe in, and then we'll talk about it. So the captain would read the Bible, and every so many days the chaplain would check in on him, and he would ask him, well, is there something you have found that you can't believe in? And the captain would just look up from his reading and smile and go back to reading. One day, as the chaplain arrived at work, he was met by a young orderly. He told him the captain, old sea captain, had just died. The chaplain raced to the old sea captain's room, and there he was, lying on his bed, dead, with the New Testament still clutched in his hands. And so the chaplain gently took the New Testament out of the sea captain's hand, and he began thumbing through it. And as he thumbed through the New Testament, he did not find one red mark, nothing under it. But when he came to John 3:16, in the margin, he found written in that red ink these words, quote, I have cast my anchor in a safe harbor. I am at peace. Thank God. Pentecost reminds us that the Holy Spirit gives us that peace which passes all understanding, so that we are in that safe harbor, that we are at peace with God. The second thing that Pentecost does for us is that it reminds us that the Holy Spirit teaches us what we need to know about our faith and about our Lord Jesus Christ. As we go back to verse 26 of our gospel reading today, Jesus says, quote, He, speaking of the Holy Spirit, he will teach you all things and bring you to remember all that I have said. He will teach you all things and bring to remembrance all that I have said. The word translated as teach means to instruct someone. It means to influence them with a teaching. It means to enable someone to understand something they have not been able to understand before. So the Holy Spirit teaches us that Jesus Christ is the Messiah, the Son of God, the Savior of the world. As Luther likes to describe it in his explanation to the third article of the Creed, I believe that I cannot, by my own understanding or effort, believe in Jesus Christ my Lord or come to him, but the Holy Spirit has called me through the gospel. What is Luther saying? He's saying that the Holy Spirit teaches us through the gospel. The Holy Spirit teaches us through the Word. And how does the Holy Spirit do this? Through the reading of the Word, the studying of the Word, proclaiming of the Word, hearing the Word, and also through worship, where we center on the Word of God. Again, St. Paul says in Romans 10:17, quote, so faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the Word of Christ. So in order to believe in Jesus, we have to be called by the gospel through the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit opened up our heart to understanding that truth of Jesus. In Tel Aviv, there was a rabbi at the rabbinical seminary in Tel Aviv who was a professor of the Talmud. The Talmud are religious writings by rabbis over the years making commentary on the law, the first five books, what we consider to be the first five books of the Old Testament. And so he hated the Lord Jesus Christ, and he so resented him that he could not even stand to discuss Jesus or whether or not possibly he had been the Son of God, the Savior of the world. One day he was going through the marketplace and became furious as he saw a young Jewish fellow who had converted to Christianity reading the Hebrew New Testament. As he began to berate the young man for leaving his Jewish religion, the young man did nothing but hand to him that Hebrew New Testament. The rabbi took the New Testament back to his apartment. And that night in his room, he began to read. He read till 3 o'clock in the morning. 3 o'clock in the morning, the Holy Spirit convicted him of his sin and of his salvation in Jesus Christ. As he announced his conversion to the Christian faith, he said these words, quote, I have already found more than 200 passages in the New Testament that prove beyond a doubt that Jesus is truly the Messiah, end of quote. So the Holy Spirit teaches us, calls us to the gospel, so that we know Jesus, and so that we can commit ourselves to Jesus and grow in a closer bond with Jesus. The word remind means to suggest to the memory or to put something in your mind. So the Holy Spirit puts the faith in Jesus Christ into our minds and understanding of Jesus Christ into our minds. This is why we talk about the Bible being the inspired word of God. It wasn't that a bunch of people just sat around and decided one day, oh, well, I'm going to write a story about Jesus. Was the Holy Spirit came to them and told them what to write, told them which events to remember, told them which events to put down in detail, which ones to just vaguely mention, told them why to put this in your gospel that somebody else didn't put into theirs. And so it's the Holy Spirit that puts in our mind the teaching of the Lord Jesus Christ. And third, the purpose of Pentecost, what Pentecost does is that it strengthens our faith. In the 29th verse of this 14th chapter, which was not part of our gospel reading for today, it cut off before it. Verse 29, Jesus says, and now I have told you before it takes place, meaning before the Holy Spirit comes, so that when it does take place, you may believe.
So the Holy Spirit comes so that we may believe. It comes so that it may strengthen our faith. The word believe means to give credit to. It means to entrust yourself to someone, to commit yourself to someone. It means to have confidence in someone. It means to place your life in their hands. And so it is the Holy Spirit strengthening our faith that enables us to put our life in the hands of Jesus Christ. To trust Jesus in no matter what kind of situation we are in, positive or negative. It is the Holy Spirit that enables us to grow in that faith so we are not intimidated when we are challenged because of our faith. It is that Holy Spirit that enabled Peter and Paul, the other apostles, to face persecution as they spread the good news of the gospel throughout the Roman Empire. It is the same Holy Spirit that enables you to stand up for your Christian faith today, that enables missionaries to continue to spread the good news of the gospel in countries where they are also very hostile to the Christian faith. It is the same Holy Spirit that enables our brothers and sisters in Christ in those areas that ISIS controls to continue to proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, even though they know it very well will probably mean the end of their earthly life. It is the Holy Spirit that gives us that strength. That is why Pentecost is still important. That is why it still has an impact on your life as a 21st century Christian. That is why it is still important that we acknowledge the birthday of the church and the power of the Holy Spirit today. The Holy Spirit assures us of God's peace. It teaches us and reminds us about our Savior Jesus Christ. It strengthens our faith so we can be ready in the time of trial. That is what Pentecost does for you. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
And show forth the good works of him who has called us from darkness into his marvelous light.
here and throughout our district and synod, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who administer the means of grace to us, that all pastors may preach faithfully the law and gospel, all missionaries be fruitful in their labors, and all church workers be faithful in their service, so that all who call on the name of the Lord may be saved. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the nations and those who lead them, for peace among the nations, for those who protect and defend us, and for freedom that we may serve the Lord unhindered by force or fear, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the blessing of a fruitful earth, for the needs of the poor, for the widowed and the fatherless, and for sacred devotion to the protection and care of life from the womb to the grave, that the name of the Lord may be kept in honor among all people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who serve us at home and abroad, the police, firefighters, medical personnel, and members of the armed forces, and for their protection in the exercise of their duty, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For a giving heart and a generous spirit, that the church may not lack for people and resources to do the Lord's bidding, and that we may serve willingly and joyfully our neighbor in need, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those afflicted in body or spirit, for those in pain and for those near death, that the Lord may grant them peace, patience, relief, and healing according to his gracious will, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who commune today, that they may receive with faith the Lord's flesh and blood, and be strengthened in faith to serve the Lord with all their mind, body, and spirit, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who have gone before us with the signs of peace, and who now rest from their labors, that we may follow them as they follow Christ, and be found faithful by those who come after us, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
From the arts and artisans, from music and musicians, for honest labor and noble work, that we may offer the Lord the best of our hands to his glory until he comes to finish his new creation and bring the fulfillment of all things, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Through our Lord Jesus Christ, all glory, honor, and worship is yours, Almighty Father and the Holy Spirit, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Let us pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts toward those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care and prepare us now for the feast on the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. St. John practices an open communion. For all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior, who believe his body and blood are truly present as we gather at his table, and are of communion age in their own individual congregation, you're invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of Lord. As that you please turn to page 6 in your bulletin as we continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
Taste and see that the Lord Thank you.
This concludes our Pentecost service for today, May 15, 2016. St. John's Lutheran Church is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Telephone number is 937-323-7508. St. John's has a outreach store open Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday, 9:30 to 1, closed on Thursday. The food pantry open every Wednesday, 9 o'clock to 10:45. We have rainbow table every Friday from noon till 1. Everybody is welcome to enjoy a meal. There's Christian school program for preschool age 3 and pre-K age 4. Drive-in service starts Memorial Day weekend, May 29th, 8 o'clock service, Memorial Day through Labor Day. Again, thank you for attending our service, watching us on YouTube. Join us at the drive-in service starting May 29th. The next two Sundays at 8 o'clock here at the sanctuary and at 10:30 in the sanctuary.